Yeah, guys, just thought I'd say hello. I'm Jack, obviously. Fucking thanks for listening to the show and that, mate. Fucking let me know what you think of it when you're done with it. Fucking send it to a mate, put it on your Instagram stories. It's probably one of the better ways you can share it with people. Leave a review, mate, if you're listening somewhere where you can leave a review. Otherwise, I'll let you get on with the show, mate. Yeah. Yeah, alright, guys. I'm the world around you, and this is Pause for Thought on Threshold FM. And this week, as promised, you know, after last episode, I've been looking into the ancient Grecian creation story, which it really sounds like a good name for something, doesn't it? Ancient Grecian creation. It just flows off the tongue, you know. And it is the name for something, though, as well, you know, I guess. You know, for those of you, though, that aren't familiar with the word Grecian, that's the word for Greek. And it's also a type of saw that you use as well when you're pruning trees. And I don't understand why. I never understood why a Grecian saw is called a Grecian saw. There's a part of me, after learning about this or all of this, part of me thinks it's because a Grecian blade is a curved blade. And one of the Greek gods created a curved blade for another deity so that they could perform some fucking horrendous task with it. Except everything I've looked at to do with this curved blade gives the idea that this blade was actually a scythe rather than a saw itself. And a scythe's normally like a clear blade, you know, smooth with no teeth. Like a pensioner's upper jaw, you know. Anyway, let's have a song to get us going. This is Shotty Horror's new song with Love Is Dead. So, long before Greece was Greece, you know, before it was called Greece, it was nothingness along with the rest of the universe as we know it, you know. It was just black, nothing. The vast nothingness that the Greeks referred to as the nothingness. That was called chaos, right? Which in itself, it wasn't actually nothing. It was a feminine deity that had always existed, apparently. Which seems like it could be some form of allegory for the womb. And the womb is important, you know, throughout all of creation, in any story, in real life, you know, in modern day, the womb's very important for creating new people. Very, very difficult to make a person without a womb, I would argue. I mean, you can do some stuff in test tubes in that, like through IBM, you know, but I'm not sure how they do that. It's just all, you know, I know they use computers and stuff, but I'm not overly sure how they do it. Anyway, but this learning about this and chaos as a deity does make me wonder where all this stuff comes from, where feminists are ranting, you know, about how women aren't represented throughout history and stuff. And it's almost like these feminists just listen and learn rhetoric rather than actually learning anything that people actually know about, you know what I mean? So this dark emptiness of chaos, it exploded and created some light, you know, like in the other stories, you know, Ra made light in the last episode we did. In Christianity, God said, let there be light. In this one, chaos just blew up the woman. Chaos, the woman, blew herself up and then light appeared. And for some reason, it's unexplained, but that allowed for the existence of Gaia. Right, and as far as I can tell, Gaia's another woman who's very, very important to the story. I'd say without Gaia, the rest of it becomes impossible. Though not strictly a woman, no, either. She's not exactly a woman. She's not quite a she. Not in the very modern sense of she's not a she. She's a they or out like that. It's more of an it, because it's kind of a planet, kind of a spiritual deity, kind of an entity, kind of also corporeal, I think. Like, you could touch her, supposedly. And people did touch her. Well, not people, but gods did touch her. She loved gods touching her, basically. That's her whole shtick, mate, is getting dick, basically. But we'll get into that, you know. As I say, she wasn't a human. She was she was known as a primordial, right? And a load of these other original deities after chaos were called primordials. And if the first primordial and their creator, right, both of them were women, so Gaia and Chaos were both women, then it's fair to assume, right, that the primordial gloop that scientists claim that we all come from and that we all grew from must be some form of cosmic vaginal discharge, which raises the question of what caught the cosmic gloop that we all come from and live in. In many women's lives, right, in our world, It's that padded built-in pocket of the knickers that is used for, you know, smuggling AA batteries onto a plane. But for an unfathomable godlike entity of pure darkness, it's hard to imagine what that would be. Anyway, Gaia was a huge woman, right, with green hair, who had a thing for filth. So what she did was she collected a load of dirt, and not on her neighbours like a gossiper, like an old-fashioned woman, but she had green hair, so she's a very modern woman. And she wasn't looking for gossip on the primordials either, you know. It was just in the literal sense of dirt. She piled up the dirt around herself, and then she became the earth. And as a woman with green hair, and as a, you know, a particularly larger woman, it shows yet another reason why SJWs and feminists should be really big into the ancient Greeks. Now, there were other primordials, though, as well, which I did say a minute ago, and I'm unsure how an SJW, a social justice warrior, for those of you that aren't in the know, I don't know how they would react to these other primordials. For example, you got Tartarus. Let's view him as the god of the underworld, just for, well, because that's what he was, kind of. Except the underworld is sort of an alternate dimensional prison with fucking mad, mental, crazy creatures in there that seem to have already existed before chaos erupted. And the reason why I'm unsure about how the average social justice warrior's reaction to Tartarus would be is because Tartarus is described as dark-skinned. So, yes, that means there's representation there. And he's got skin that's hard like diamond, so he's got a pretty good superpower there and all. But he's also kind of the evil guy. And I'm not sure if this is the equivalent to how when, like, I know when my parents were younger and they were watching telly, all the villains on telly were Russians. So I'm not sure if this is just the same with Tartarus being dark-skinned. Is that a way for the ancient Greeks to have been like, oh, you know, we don't like Africa because, you know, maybe the ancient Egyptian law had worked its way over to Greece, I'm not sure, you know. And they were like, well, we want to disregard all of that entirely and focus on our own stuff, so we'll make the dark-skinned guy the bad guy. I'm not sure, you know. But either way, you know, Tartarus is also the name of the underworld itself, so he named the underworld after himself. And it's a very important place in the rest of the story, and we'll come back to that later. There was another one as well that got thrown around the stories, another primordial called Eros, which is A-I-R-O-S, right, who's the god of love. But they're simply just mentioned and brought up, thrown around a little bit, you know. They're not really relevant apart from helping to further the plot of creation a little bit. Now, there were two other beings as well which were important at the very beginning, and that's Nyx and Arabis. Now, Nyx was the goddess of night, whilst Arabis was the god of shadows, and he was made entirely from, they explained it as like a misty darkness. But a misty darkness is a shadow, innit? So he was the god of shadows and created just of shadows, except for his eyes. His eyes were apparently very real. And from what I could tell from the descriptions on Nyx, Nyx was also made of darkness, but not quite shadows, and somehow kind of owned the stars in kind of a cape that followed her around like an ethereal cape, and they were the stars of the night sky. But she wasn't quite in control of them, because that would be given to her, that power would be given to a deity much later on, and they would then inherit that power, I think directly from Nyx, from my understanding. But anyway, thanks to the existence of Eros, the god of love, Nyx and Arabis were able to lock eyes, you know. Arabis had been hanging around in the bathroom, you know, whispering from the shadows about Chupa Chups, and taunting the other three gods as when they'd go for a piss, mocking them, you know, for their use of their genitals, either, you know, saying, oh, they're too small, or too many flaps, you know, too much flappage. It didn't matter to Arabis what the genitals actually looked like, because he was jealous, you know, he didn't have them, he was a shadow. He was just angry because he was a shadow creature, you know, and he was trying to take it out on them. And then one night, he was peering over the bathroom stall to watch Nyx take a piss. And Nyx looked him dead in the eye and said, what's wrong with you? You're in here every night, but I've never seen you at the bar. Do you work here? Arabis started to blush, which obviously no one could tell because he was made from
literal shadows. But we've got his handwritten accounts that I've scribbled down here on the back of this receipt, and that says that he was embarrassed for the first time, and instead of commenting on how saggy Nixie's flaps were and telling her that a clit looked like a little willy and that she should be proud of it because it's bigger than Tartarus's willy, instead of saying any of that, he complimented her on how much she respected Gaia. He said it was obvious that she respected Gaia because she was the only one that would use one sheet of toilet roll. And he started to explain how it's really difficult to get the trees to be replanted for the creation of the bog roll. And apparently, this made Nix laugh a little bit, and she looked at Arabis and said what every toilet attendant dreams of hearing. Do you want to touch it? Obviously, Arabis was overjoyed from this, you know, this simple display of affection from Nix. And they were able to live happily with each other, Nix and Arabis, for however long their relationship lasted. You know, and not every relationship is supposed to last for years. Some will only last for weeks and they'll be amazing. Some will last for months and you'll think about them for the rest of your life. Well, Nix and Arabis had one of those relationships, you know, dependent on how long it lasted. But they really enjoyed themselves, apparently. And it could have all happened in a bathroom stall. And that's why, guys, that's why you've got to be more open to interactions in public toilets, because it could change your life. You know, it could be something. You could have an interaction in a public toilet with a person, and that could affect you for the rest of your life, and you're stopping that from happening. Anyway, this newfound love, this meant that Nix's attention was taken away from caring for Gaia, and Gaia got a little bit jealous of the love that Nix and Arabis were sharing, and like many lonely older women, she did the only sensible thing imaginable. She had a child. Now, Gaia, the hermaphroditic. We're imagining she's got a dick and a hole, you know, like a, well, not just a bumhole, a fanny hole, you know. Anyway, she, like Godzilla, this primordial managed to create her own lover out of herself. She plucked the new being into existence from her own person. And that being was Uranus. Now, Uranus was about 8 foot tall, which makes him sound a lot like a giant. And apparently he was quite intimidating as well, by all accounts. And he became the god of the sky immediately. And he's responsible for the dome that's placed over the flat earth, or for the blue sky and atmosphere that mainstream scientists believe in. Now, not content with a new lover, Gaia demanded more companions. Not sexual companions, though, as far as we're aware. The other two were just friends, or in layman's terms, children, or clones. But they weren't identical children, or they weren't like twins or out, and they weren't identical clones. They were just made of her, like Uranus was, except she was only planning on playing with Uranus. She was, she, like, you know, in a sexual way. Her and Uranus were going to be went on to be very sexual together. They did a lot of things. She did a lot of things to Uranus, and Uranus did a lot of things to her. But the other children that she made, they weren't, you know, and they were called Eurus and Pontus. And Eurus would become the mountains and Pontus would become the seas, which could be where we get the idea for the name of pontoon from. You know, because obviously in many places you have to be 21 to have consensual sex. And let's have a song. This is English Frank with A Message.
Some of you obviously don't know, because I can see how many people listen to the show, so I thought I'd let you know about my other show. I've got another podcast now called Truth Seek, and it's me and a comedian called Jimmy Budd, and we talk about different conspiracies. Imagine this, except there's another person kind of reining me in and keeping me kind of on track. And also cracking jokes as well. It's funny, mate. Like, Jimmy makes me laugh, I make Jimmy laugh. And hopefully it will make you laugh and all. So that's Truth Seeking. You'll probably be able to find it through one of the links underneath. Please give it a listen and go and give Jimmy a follow on Instagram and that. Let him know what you think of the shows. I'll let you crack on with this though for now.
Right, so all Gaia wanted was what every parent wants for their child, right? I mean, not immediately, you know. I mean, it was immediately in this case, because they're primordials and they're like gods, you know, monsters. But monsters in more than one sense of the word, realistically. If you're going to introduce your child to this quickly, you know, you end up in our world, you'd end up in Nick. But they wanted what Gaia wanted for her child, what every parent wants, right? When their child gets to a certain age, because you want to know that they're normal. So what she wanted was, she wanted for a kid to get the willy wet. But as a giant deity, that's going to be pretty hard, isn't it? But Gaia did what many mothers fail to do. She put out. And it could be where the saying, her legs have got separate postcodes, comes from. Because with Gaia being the actual Earth, right, it's very possible that that could be true. It's also unexplained how Uranus was able to make love to the planet-sized Gaia. It doesn't go into it, but we can all use our imaginations, you know, we all know how sex works. Well, right? Don't we? You know, just to make sure that we all know how sex works, tell me in the Discord how you think it works. Anyway, Uranus, right? Uranus slipped one up Gaia, and Gaia either enjoyed it, right, or had nothing else to do, because, you know, they must have done it a few times, because they had a bunch of weird children together, and they birthed titans and monsters, and no matter which way you look at this, right, the numbers surrounding it seem important, right? So she birthed 12 titans, and there's that number that comes up every week, 12, 12 comes up every week. It's also included in another part of Grecian story with Hercules and the 12 labours, which Hercules plus 12 equals 13, right? But then if you look at this in another way, she and also with the monsters, she had 6 monsters apparently, which has got to have been a result of the inbreeding, so she's quite lucky that she didn't end up having all 18 of them being monsters. But I mean, in many ways, they kind of all were monsters, because they were, most of them were mental anyway. But these monsters, apparently she had 3 cyclops and 3 monsters called Hecatoncheires, which were these mental-looking creatures with shitloads of heads and hands and arms, you know. The hands were on the ends of the arms, you know, not that makes it any better. But they were fucking weird-looking anyway, innit? And they were cast to Tartarus to be imprisoned because they weren't much good for anything, just scaring the other kids, basically. These Hecatoncheires could be another, again, where we get the phrase all fingers and thumbs, because they weren't good for anything, and they were predominantly hands. But you're probably wondering anyway why this 6 creatures, these 6 monsters are important, right? Well, if you add 12, right, to 6, you get 18. And then with numbers, right, in numerology and stuff like that, when you're using numbers for science, not like science, like, you know, but science, but when you're using numbers for science. So you add the numbers together then, because they're a double-digit number, or if they're a treble-digit number. So in the same sense where if you add, let's say 666, you add that together, you get 18, which is useful because it's the same number, and it also shows the relevance of this. So 18, you get 18, you add 1 and 8, gives you 9, right? And 9 is a highly symbolic number to the people or the creatures that seem to be in control of our world. Or at least, you know, according to the people that are into numbers and numerology and the people that point all this stuff out. Now, the 12 titans each had something that they were each in charge of. So we got Cronos. Cronos, he was in charge of harvests and agriculture. And I think somehow he got linked to the Grim Reaper of modern day as well, because he we won't get into it, but he seems to be linked to the Grim Reaper in death as well. But, right, if he was another worldly being that was responsible for introducing and being responsible for agriculture and harvests to this world, then that's got to mean that in some way, shape or form, he's Quetzalcoatl, the reptilian alien responsible for introducing corn to North America, and quite possibly responsible for the sugars created by the corn syrup. But I mean, this isn't important. This show's still not about Quetzalcoatl and that, but it's weird that yet again harvests, it comes up with the number 12. Quetzalcoatl's there, the same story's there, but it's from a different part of the world. Anyway, the next Titan number 2, we got Oceanus. And they were responsible for salt water. So I'm not overly sure what sort of relationship they had with Pontus, or if Pontus was like their boss, and then Oceanus had to kick up and kick down and kick up and kick up and kick down and kick up and kick down and wave her arms about, you know, to tread water, and also to pay up to Pontus, because if Pontus was their boss, then maybe this was a means of splitting up territories like a mob boss would do, you know. They'd split up the salt water and the fresh water to make governing it easier, because I mean, who knows, because Titan number 3 was Healthies, who was responsible for the fresh water of the world. Now, the next one, Titan number 4, I assume worked alongside Nyx, or at least apprenticed underneath her, and this was Crius. And they were in charge of the star constellations. I mentioned them before, you know, the star constellations that surround our Earth, you know, in the dome. Possibly, meaning that they were responsible for the messages that get hidden within the skies, like putting, you know, where the greys come from on Orion's belt and stuff like that, you know. And things like that, little messages. And they were, if they were responsible for organising that, then they must have been orchestrated by Titan number 5, which was Coeus, the one that was assigned the gift and the role of intelligence and farsight, which was weirdly, right, in the illustrations of all of these that I looked at, the only one that was drawn next to or as an owl. The rest of them were drawn as mostly people. This guy, drawn as an owl, which, now, none of the others were represented as animals, so maybe this is a little clue in itself, kind of like what Crius would do with the constellations. Maybe this is our way of people above us, our bosses, so, you know, our equivalent of Nyx, giving us little hints. So maybe Moloch is actually Coeus, possibly, I don't know. Because a lot of American politicians apparently talk to an owl at night time. Then we've got Titan number 6, which is Hyperion, the Titan of Light. Hyperion is a name as well that gets used a lot in pop culture, and the first one that sprung to mind for me is Borderlands. I'm pretty sure it's Handsome Jack's business name. Also, as well, it's worth remembering that Lucifer is the so-called God of Light, and from the Luciferians' point of view. So Satan, basically. So Hyperion could be Satan. Then you've got the Palladians as well, which are often associated with the light and fighting for the light. Now, I don't know if, again, I don't know, I can't remember off the top of my head if they're, I think they're fighting on behalf of the light, not fighting for control of the light, if you know what I mean, not trying to take over the light. But I've been wondering if these Titans were, maybe, you know, if the Hyperion are the Palladians, that's one of the main alien races. So, could it be possible that these Titans are responsible for, and the kind of the names given to the many different races that interact with our universe? Does that make sense to people? I mean, I couldn't find anything to prove that, but it's possible. Especially with, like, the theologian idea of the seven root races kind of thing, you know. But there's obviously 12 here. And, you know, Titan number 7 is Iapetes. And they're a pretty weird one. They control the lifespan of mortals. So I'm guessing she just sits there with a dial, twisting it every now and then, you know, like an old-fashioned TV or like your girlfriend's nipples when you're bored. And it's a possibility, right, that when humans have these periods of dying younger, that Iapetes might have just nipped out of her office to the toilet, so she just lets them all die sooner so that the world doesn't get overpopulated. And maybe now the reason why the world's getting overpopulated is because Iapetes is maybe on the phone or eating a dinner or something. You know, I don't know how long it takes for a primordial being to eat dinner. Well, these aren't primordials now at this point. These are the Titans. And speaking of Titans, Titan number 8 is Taya, who's got maybe the worst associated skill, or whatever you could call this. Association, I guess. I'm not sure if they are skills. Shining. Just shining. I haven't got a clue. I don't know what that would be, but I guess that Taya is the equivalent of the, you know, in like the Majestic 12 episode, I suggested maybe they've got a special needs brother, a sibling in the Majestic 12 who lives in the loft and fucking drip feeds a bit of information to the humans. Maybe Taya's that. I don't know, maybe Taya's that. They just gave a shining, you know, like this kind of the equivalent of the special bus kid of the family. Like they just get to be the god of glitter, you know, and maybe they were far too emotional, you know, to be able to be in charge of, you know, for example, Law and Order, which was left to Titan number 9. Demas, who had quite a long run, you know. Demas did quite well. He managed 20 years in charge of Law and Order before he took up an executive producer role on NCIS. And Memory was assigned to Titan number 10. Nemesine, who must have worked alongside the Prophetic Radiance, which, you know, that's they've got to be the one with the ability to see the future. I think Prophetic Radiance. And you can easily know what will happen in the future by observing history, or at least the history books in school, which were written to ready the population for the various events within them. Possibly, you know, if you look at it that way. Just with, you know, obviously with different names and costumes. And by the way, the Titan of prophetic radiance is actually Titan number 11, which was Phoebe. That was her name. And then we've got quite possibly the reason why there are kids in schools in the first place. And that one's Titan number 12. And that's Rhea, who was in charge of fertility and motherhood. Anyway, let's have a song. This is Dead Players with Yeah.
Alright mate, just a little quick little advert for myself. If you're enjoying this, fucking join the Patreon, mate, if you can. For a little as a quid, 2 quid, 3 quid, tenner, whatever you want to throw on there, you get the same stuff either way. Obviously it's nicer if you put like 3 quid on rather than a quid, because I'll only get like 75p out of the quid, but still it's 75p more than what I'm getting now. It's just you get access to video versions of these, discounts for canvases and maybe some other little bits off my website, and you get access to the PDF versions, that's the digital download versions of my books. Anyway, I'll let you get back onto your show.
Ironically, there was nothing that Rhea could do, though, when Uranus decided to do the exact opposite of what nature had intended, or what Rhea was made for. Now, Uranus started gripping his and Gaia's kids, right? Grabbing them all, gripping them, you know, grabbing them, collecting them. He became almost like the Pied Piper, I guess. So there's another connection to another episode. But what Uranus did was he took a tight grip of all of the children that he'd had with Gaia, and he started ramming them back up Gaia's hole. Now, there is a part of me as well that's wondering, is this kind of where Scientologists get the idea for the volcanoes, with Zeno dumping people in volcanoes and that, you know, well, not people, but aliens and monsters and stuff. So I'm not sure if that's where that comes from, but let's ignore that for now. So, after ramming a good few handfuls of Titans up Gaia's fanny, and then packing out a womb with her own children, which, to be fair to Uranus, right, she wasn't adverse to accommodating her own children, but it was more for a short sort of short stay. And, you know, maybe a return visit, you know. Let them pop in for a bit, you know, and pop in and pop out, you know. Not really the long stay kind of thing, you know. She wasn't like a... She wasn't an apartment, you know. She was more of an Airbnb kind of thing. But anyway, Uranus had gotten them back in there, you know, and reconstructed some form of hymen. I don't know how, but let's imagine it's just cement powder thrown in there, because obviously she's Gaia, so she'll already have the sand, and the moisture's there because she's involved in yet another sexcapade with the children, so she's obviously kind of, maybe I would imagine, a little bit wet because she likes doing stuff with her kids. And we can say what we want about her, because she might not be real, so it's fine, you know. And then, right, the mystical cement blocks, they formed a wall and blocked the kids in there. But for some reason, right, whatever reason, it must have been good in there, must have been quite nice, you know, because none of the Titans wanted to break free, all except for Cronus, right? And Cronus, he didn't give a shit, right? He was just happy for a scrap with his dad, brother, uncle. They were all Uranus is definitely his dad, but also his brother. Because even if he was his half-brother, because he's got a different dad, like Uranus was just made of Gaia, right? So Uranus is Gaia. Cronus is the child of Gaia and Uranus, but Uranus is just Gaia, so they're kind of also brothers. And it's kind of Gaia's sibling, because it was made to be along the line of Gaia, so I don't know what you would call him. Well, we can call him his dad to make it easier, because he was his dad. But he was also kind of his brother, kind of his uncle. This is a bit weird of this in this story now. It gets a bit stranger because it starts to really tie in with modern day popular culture again. And that's the introduction of adamantium, or adamantine, which is very similar to what I just said there, adamantium. And if you want to get really weird, could be quite similar to what's in Avatar with unobtainium. Just spelt differently, but it's very similar kind of idea. But this stuff, right, this adamantine, it's exactly like what's in the Marvel comics with what they give fucking what they changed Wolverine's bones into and what they gave Captain America for his shield. Except I think in the MCU they call it vibranium, I think. But in the comics it was adamantium. I don't think they can use adamantium because Fox had bought adamantium as a name or something. I don't know. But adamantium was the name of the metal in the comics as far as I can remember. Anyway, Gaia managed to use her womanly wiles, right, to make Cronus a scythe out of this unbreakable adamantine. And then Cronus hid deep in Gaia's vagina, until the moment was right for him to launch his attack. And that moment would come just as Uranus was smashing their collective mother's cervix, just as Uranus was relaxing into his rhythm and Cronus had reached out from the vagina and gripped his brother dad's balls and sliced them off with his adamantine scythe. Ironic, in a way, that he harvested his dad's seed, I guess, for the Titan of Agriculture and Harvest, which could be how he got his name. Maybe he got his name retrospectively, maybe he isn't Quetzalcoatl. Maybe he's just a fucking psychopath with a scythe, I don't know. And he may have also slashed his dick as well, but that's not recorded. But we can imagine, you know, if you wanna think he slashed his dad's dick to ribbons as well, or maybe just ribbon that bottom, you know, that bottom bit of your dick that's kind of like you someone's maybe packed out. Imagine when you get a sock, right, and you pack a sock with other socks, and then you put, say you was to get a metal straw, one of them very modern metal straws, and put it at the bottom of the sock or anywhere, and then put that line to the bottom, that little ridge there that you get there. Let's imagine just for a moment, guys, that Cronus also sliced that bit there when he did this to his dad's bollocks. And then he took his bollocks, and he was stood there, Cronus is stood there, dick in hand, not his dick, but, you know, still, caught in the act. And he took his bollocks, and he just fucking dashed them into the ocean, mate, from wherever he was. Now, this could be why, right, if you think about the oceans, right, what do we have in the oceans, what's there a lot of in the oceans? Sea monkeys, right, and his cum was obviously enchanted and capable of, you know, capable of making monsters, so it might be why there's so many weird things also living in the sea, you know, like fucking sea cucumbers, urchins, hammerhead sharks, lionfish, because if you look at all of those things, none of those make sense at all. And there's no evidence for that, though. I mean, what we do know, though, is that his testicles managed to transform into the goddess Aphrodite whilst his blood spilled on the ground on Gaia, and that's why we're imagining that he sliced the metal straw of tubing, whatever that bit of your penis is called. Maybe he sliced that, made blood come out everywhere. And then what they created, that blood there, created nymphs, giants, and furies. Now, I'm not sure what furies are, but I have made a note not to pronounce it as furries. You know, seems like a cheap joke. But interesting that Uranus wasn't actually classed as a giant, and this is what created the giants. So, if we want to take this into the sort of Anunnaki line of thought, the giants were made by the Anunnaki, so that could make Uranus an Anunnaki and make Gaia possibly Anu, or whatever was above Anu, before Anu, evolutionarily speaking, but Anu being like the king of the universe, the king of the Anunnaki, the leader, and then they created the giants here. So maybe Uranus was the equivalent of Enki and Enlil or something, and they created on Earth the giants, because if you look at it as the blood dripped on Earth and that formed giants, you could also read blood as genetically engineered from the moon and then beamed them. That's the blood dripping is the beam from the moon onto Earth, and then giants were made. Anyway, Uranus was shocked, you know, he was in a bit of shock. He was Well, he was a bit taken back, you know, he didn't expect this at all, who would? And in response to this act of self-defence from Cronus, he simply said, "I'll get you for this!" And he fucking ran away into the Nyx. Now, in celebration of a lover's castration at a son's hand, Gaia decided that she'd reward the humans with what is now referred to as the Golden Age, a time where humans didn't have to hunt, you know, didn't have to gather, didn't have to really worry about survival. Everyone had exactly what they needed. No need to work, no need for war, for fights, to be upset. Just bliss throughout the world and possibly throughout the entire universe. Now, after a while, though, Cronus did get bored of this. Like, the quiet life is nothing compared to freeing your siblings from the womb of your cosmic mother whilst detesticulating for your own dad, you know, who's also your brother. Nothing's going to compare, you know, he is going to get itchy feet, and he was. He needed something to do, so he decided to take his Cyclops and Hecatonchires siblings, right, and I think he then casted them back to Tartarus, which I think, from my understanding, I think they'd been released from Tartarus at this point, because they were put there a lot earlier on by Uranus, I think, And then, or by Gaia, because she wasn't keen, they brought them back. They're like, we'll have these out again. We'll bring them back like fucking vanilla Monster Munch meat. The crisp that makes you sick. We brought back the Cyclops. We brought back the fucking Hecatoncheles. And then they're like, right, we've had enough of this. It's not worked out again, you know. I don't know what's had a reprisal and then gone away again. I think Vanilla Coke disappeared again, and it there we go, the vanilla again. That's the thing, isn't it? Vanilla. So that's what Cyclops and Hecatoncheles are. That's what the big they are trying to convince you, that vanilla means boring and plain, but really what it means is one-eyed massive monsters and multiple-handed, multiple-faced, four-legged beings that were the brothers of a titan that once ruled the universe. And then he cast them, right? He got them and he cast them back to Tartarus to be imprisoned with other monsters. And they were watched over, right, by this so-called she-dragon, which, again, you know, fucking feminist dream. Not only is it a woman working, right, it's a huge position of power, and it's basically a woman in charge. You know, very forward-thinking, these Greeks. You know, they've got Coeus and Phoebe to thank for that. Coeus being Titan number 10. And Phoebe obviously being Titan number 11. And, you know, that's possibly where all this women in work movement comes from. Now, Cronos, who was, if you remember rightly, Cronos was Titan number 1. He had a similar libido to his dad and decided that he would start shagging his sister, Rhea. Now, they'd had 5 kids by this point, and Cronos was riddled with his paranoia, right? Possibly, I would imagine, induced by some form of PTSD from all of the incest stuff and the removal of his dad's testicles by his own hand. Maybe it was caused by hiding within his mum's own womb. Who knows, right? But either way, you know, fucking paranoid to fuck. So, he did what anyone would do. And he listened to the prophecies of his parents. You won't amount to shit. You're fucking weird. Get in your bedroom. You'll live in that bedroom. If you keep wanking, you'll go blind. You know, but instead his mum and dad were saying things to him, you know, like, your children will rise up against you and kill you. So Cronus decided to cut out the middleman this time. You know, he wasn't going to stuff him up into Rhea's womb. He wasn't going to use Rhea to trap the kids in any way, shape or form. Just let him. And trapped him in his own belly. That way, he can't, you know, take part in a sexual act, and his own siblings and nephews and kid can't attack his lover and get out. You know, nothing like that. They're just trapped in his stomach. Now it's a lot harder. Realistically, it's a lot harder to get into someone's belly than into a womb, right? Because I would imagine, right? Because if you help a cow give birth, you can shove your arm up the cow's fanny and probably stick your hand in its womb. I imagine. I think that's what farmers do. I've always thought that's what farmers do. And vets. Probably more so vets. Maybe the odd farmer. Maybe the odd pervert as well. Now, if you could probably do that with a large enough woman if you wanted to. Not a petite thing. Not a little petite woman. And I'm not saying, you know, not like a short, big, larger woman. I mean like a tall woman. You may be able to get past the cervix with your wrist and have a feel round in the womb. Probably won't do her any good, but that's a hell of a lot easier than getting your hand down someone's esophagus into their belly to drag out the children that they've just eaten. You must agree, you know. So Cronus thought the same, and he thought that the kids would be trapped in there, right? But Rhea, she wasn't that keen on a fella eating all of her nephews and children and nieces, you know. And realistically, Cronus should have been paranoid about that as well, but he wasn't, you know. And I don't understand why he wasn't. He was a really paranoid guy, but why not just kill them? If you're being told your kids are going to rise up against you, why keep them alive? Why trap them somewhere and potentially piss them off more? He might not have even annoyed them up until that point. It might have been the trapping them in his belly that pissed them all off. But why not just kill them? Because when he eats them, right, they could have poisoned him. You know, they might not have been good eating. He could have choked on one of them, you know. And which, now all of that makes me think that they must be sort of immortal, so why not just fucking trap them in the earth? Not in Gaia, though, there's the problem in Gaia. Maybe that's what the moon is. Maybe the moon isn't a genetic splicing facility. Maybe the moon is literally a prison, and that's where they've put them, and they've put them out of Gaia's reach, out of the dome of Uranus that Uranus built over the flat earth, and inside the moon is fucking five, potentially five gods and a rock. And I say a rock, not because of, you know, it's not a reference to Dwayne Johnson. It's nothing like that. Though many may say he looks like a god, it's nothing to do with that. Rhea decided to trick him. Rhea got sick of Cronus eating her kids, basically. And with the sixth child, Rhea decided to trick the very, very confident yet very paranoid Cronus by feeding him a rock that was inside of a cape. And he fell for it, mate. Meaning, right, that she could then send Zeus, who was the sixth child to be eaten. She sent him off to be raised by nymphs. Now, when I read this story in other places referred to the, didn't mention nymphs. A lot of other places said goats. Hard to believe. So I'm not sure if goats just means animals, or if nymphs just means animals, or if goats was used in more modern ways to try and talk the nymphs down as if they don't exist, because I'm pretty sure the nymphs are a part of the fae, which seems to be a taxonomical class of creature that's being wiped from history and getting replaced with aliens. Like the Loch Ness Monster and cryptids and that, people still know about them, but less and less people are aware of the fae and the existence of the fae. Everyone just goes, oh, what you're describing is an alien. Alien. That's a grey, not a fae. And they even rhyme and sound similar, you know. So it's just a way to blur them waters there, you know. Anyway, after a while of growing up and what I assume was like a training montage set to a bit of Phil Collins, Zeus returned in order to save his siblings from the cage that their dad had trapped them in, which does seem very familiar to what Cronus had done just before. And it's a shame, really, it is. It's a massive shame, because I feel like if Zeus and Cronus had just sat down and had a chat, if Cronus and Uranus had just sat down and had a chat, they'd probably realise that the three of them had quite a lot in common. But like many fathers, Cronus just saw their children as a reminder of their lost youth. And Zeus used some form of magical potion that made Cronus throw up after pretending to be Cronus's mug carrier. You know, he brought him his morning coffee and morning brew for a few weeks, and then one day put a little bit of poison in it. And Epicac or fucking... what else makes you throw up violently? Sambuca, maybe, in his coffee, you know. And then he threw them all up, Cronus did. Threw up the rock first, and then the five kids in the reverse order of what they were swallowed, like they'd just all been in there, sat on top of each other. Anyway, let's have a song. This is Smokey Joe and the Kid with Chill Bumps, and this song's called Just Walking. If you're enjoying this, right, do you know what you might like? You might like a fucking Bollock Boy, mate, which is a little robot with mouse testicles in. £6 on worldaroundyou.com. There's other stuff as well, you know, like mystery boxes and fucking things I've made out of rats and dead ducklings and that. So fucking give them a look, mate. The prices start at like fucking £1 for a piece of fossilised shell. And then prices vary going up. You can also get shirts in that as well from there. But go and have a look, mate, worldaroundyou.com. But I'm guessing if you've found this, you already know about all the taxidermy. But still, you know, maybe now's the time to treat your missus to a little mouse heart. You know, I don't know you, though. I can't tell you what to do. I'm just glad you're listening to the shows. I'll fucking let you crack on. So, after Zeus saved his siblings that led them all into this 10-year war known as the Titan Maki, though, we'll go with. Zeus and his five brothers and sisters went to war with the 12 Titans, leading them to defeat Cronus and banishing him from Tartarus. They banished him to Tartarus. And I'm saying 12 Titans as well, that's also a mistake. They definitely beat at least 12 Titans, because apparently there was loads more Titans by this point. But not all the Titans fought against the new gods, if that makes sense. Some of them fought alongside the new gods, or just stayed out of it completely, you know. And to be honest, with the Titans wise, it seems to be the ones that had the ability to see the future, which is obviously quite a clever move, you know, because like, did they know that this war's going to happen this way, or was it they could see that they didn't fight in the future, so, and they had a good relationship? Well, how do we have a good relationship? Well, it's probably best not to kill him and his friends. I don't know. Either way, it is, like I say, pretty clever. Now, Zeus decided to go to Tartarus and free his distant relatives that Cronus had imprisoned there, the Cyclops and the multi-headed, double-dozen-handed heterocateries creatures, which when you look at them and listen to other descriptions of them, they do sound quite a lot like angels, to be honest. And a lot of the monsters from down there in Tartarus sound like angels and genetically modified creatures, which seem to be one of the same, you know. But either way, Zeus fancied letting him out, you know, but to do that, right, he had to kill the she-dragon that was watching over him, so feminists, cover your ears, which seems, in a way, to be some form of act of kindness if you really look into ancient Grecian lore, because it potentially gives the she-dragon a new chance at life, according to the stuff I've been reading, because it's possible that the she-dragon is a... then went to Elysium because she was quite high up, and when she reached Elysium, she'd be given the chance to, do you want to stay in Elysium, or do you want to go back to living, do you want to go back to Tartarus, where do you want to go, what do you want to do next, because you're basically a god. And if you got to Elysium three times, you could go to the one that was a rank above Elysium, which I think's on the other page of notes, but we'll get into that in a minute. Now, I was thinking with the she-dragon, right, could that be a possible way to tell us that there's a reptilian race of draconians that seem to be in charge of grey aliens? Because greys are often associated, right, with genetic manipulation throughout all of history. So it would make sense that there's some sort of link, because in Tartarus there's loads of these genetically modified creatures, right? And the she-dragon was watching over them. Just in the same sense, if you remember the episode on the Greys when I spoke about the hierarchical structure of the alien societies, there is a level of draconian that was above the Greys and would watch over the Greys and make sure they do what they're supposed to be doing. You know, I mean, I might be wrong, you know, I could be wrong. There just seems to be some little bit of a link there, you know. Now, at this point in the story as well, it starts to get a little bit Lord of the Ringsy. The Cyclops that Zeus freed has one eye, right? Kind of like how a ring has one eye, unless you look at it from the other way, but then it's, I suppose it's still one hole. Now, and that one hole, that eye, gave magical powers to these gods, specifically to Zeus and a couple of his brothers, Poseidon and Hades. Now, Zeus was given the power to manipulate electricity and lightning, whilst Poseidon was given his trident, and Hades, which really surprised me, was given a helmet that makes him invisible, and I never knew, because, you know, I never knew he could become invisible. Didn't know that at all. Now, with these new magical artifacts and powers, the Olympians were able to win this decade-long Titanomachy. But this victory didn't go down well with Grandma. You know, Gaia got pretty pissed off with how her champion, Cronos, had been treated. You know, and once again, she medicated her own pain with sex and siblings together, you know. She relapsed, basically, started shagging her family members. But this time it was Tartarus's turn to sling one up her, and this spawned the Titan, which was a definite angel if you're into your angels and you remember the descriptions on angels. Not like the golden spinning rings with an eye in the middle, but more like the maybe the cherubim, maybe the seraphims, I can't remember the name of them. But basically, they had, because, you know, he had a lion part, humanish qualities, and reptilian parts. He even had wings, you know. So imagine fucking loads of snake heads at one end, at the head end, a lion's body, massive dragon wings coming out of its spine, and then I think it had the brain power of a person. So in every one of these stories we talk about, there's always these genetically modified creatures, mate, which is fucking mental, innit? It does all link, mate. There's links between it all, I'm sure. It's just finding them, mate, and understanding what they mean. Now, understandably, mostly, all of these new gods absolutely fucking shit it, mate, when Titan came charging towards them. All apart from Zeus, who stood his ground and defeated the new creature that was born of jealousy and anger. And then what he did with that newly made, basically a baby, Titan was kind of a baby, really, compared to all of them. Monster, massive monster, but still a baby, you know, pretty young. What he did was he buried it underneath Mount Etna, which must mean, right, that Gaia's sibling, Eurus, must have helped out in some way, because Eurus was the one that became the mountains. So, I don't know how Gaia reacted to the mountains betraying her and her children, but also helping her children. Don't know, it's not explained, again, it's not explained. Which makes it all seem like the ancient Greek story is just a way to get the ancient Egyptian story, muddy it a lot, confuse the shit out of it, stretch it out, pad it out, remove some of the plot, and to detract us, the people, modern day, away from what we're actually supposed to know about. But again, that's just my opinion and not actually the story, you know. It wasn't reported, you know, anywhere. It's just me putting two and two together. Now, Cronus may have been forgiven to a degree after a while. It's thought that he was allowed into Elysium, which, as I say, is like the Greek Valhalla, the afterlife for gods and heroes. But this means that Cronus also could have gotten that other chance at life, like the She-Dragon could have got. Now, there are some that believe that Cronus is still trapped in Tartarus, though, and will be there for all of eternity until whatever the universe is ends. But I can't help but think it seems pretty similar to the story and treatment of Set in ancient Egyptian creationism, because he was made to go back, you know, and live through the afterlife and stuff, and helped by the gods and things like that with Ra, and he would sort of redeem himself slowly, in the same sense that Tartarus would be used in order to trap Cronus, you know. But again, I'm not sure. And that's it. That's it for the ancient Greek creation story. It's a lot less concise, as I say, than the ancient Egyptian story. Makes a lot less sense, and I don't really think it explains where humans come from. It seems to just take humans for granted as if they were always there. Otherwise, you know, how could Gaia have given the humans the Golden Age so early on in the story? Whereas in ancient Egyptian creationism, the humans are created a lot further down the line after the gods have existed for a while. But it's possible, I think, that the two stories work together. Like, some of them, they do cover plot holes of the other, if you know what I mean, in a way. So if you was to stretch them both along the line and, you know, the stories, the timelines, I reckon they'd match up to a degree, and then they'd fill in the gaps of the others. And maybe that's what we're supposed to do, take all of the ancient creationism stories and put them all together in a pile and then work out how it all fills this timeline. But I don't know, who knows, you know, there are some people that think all of this historical account is just pure allegory and made up, you know. And that's all we've got time for this week, guys. Later on today, I think we've got HDR, Jimmy Budd will be about with Jim O'Mixit. And if you want a bit more of me and Jimmy, have a go and have a listen to Truth Seeking. Also, new gear on my website. There's, as I said the other week, Mothman with his cock out, canvases on the walls. If you join me Patreon, you get a discount on canvases. So instead of paying $19.99, I think you pay £15 for a canvas of some old work I'd made years ago. You can have them on your wall, like a rat person trying to shag a Barbie doll. New duck, which is a duckling with a teddy bear's head. All sorts, mate. New shirts as well. Tie-dye, trippy, spiralized shirts with the safety fox and with the original rat people, man, with his fucking Jesus piece on and his trousers down his ankles. All sorts. It's all worth a look, mate. All fucking, thanks for listening. I'll fucking see you in a bit, guys.
Thanks for listening, man. I won't take up too much of the time because it's over, and hopefully you're listening to all of these one after the other, or on repeat, maybe the same episode on repeat. But fucking leave us a review if you can, mate. Fucking share it with a mate, send it to your nana. I don't mind where you send it to, but if you get more people listening to it, thank you. If you did enjoy it though, fucking join the Patreon, mate. www.patreon.com/worldaroundyou. There'll be a link in one of the links in the description, I would imagine, of the one you're listening to. You can join for £1, £5, you know, and you get access to all the video versions of these. You'll end up about 4 or 5 episodes ahead as well through Patreon. And you get access to some of my books as well. And a little discount code for some of the canvases as well. But even if you don't join that, fucking thanks for listening to it, mate. I hope you enjoyed it. Hopefully. Here's the next one.